My talk today is on type 1 diabetes. I've been told to discuss the prevalence as well. I'll start with the prevalence of diabetes mellitus. The estimates for 2011 were 366 million worldwide. And only 15% of these people will have type 1 diabetes. Obviously, for obvious reasons, 85% of the people with diabetes have type 2. Local incidence, a study in Karachi found it to be 1.02 per 100,000. That's again not a very impressive figure. Exactly because type 2 diabetes is so much more common. We might miss the occasional type 1 diabetic among them. And this can be disastrous because prompt diagnosis and early institution of insulin therapy in the type 1 diabetic is absolutely critical. So it is crucial not to miss them, and let's try to identify the type 1 diabetic. The diagnostic criteria of diabetes include, I'm sure you all must know, polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, the osmotic symptoms, with blood sugar fasting level of more than or equal to 126 milligrams per deciliter, random blood sugar more than or equal to 200 milligrams per deciliter, and or an HbA1c of more than or equal to 6.5%. Another option is oral glucose tolerance test, in which case 2 hours after the glucose load, the blood sugar, if it goes beyond 200 milligrams per deciliter, the patient is diagnosed as diabetic. However, these criteria are uniform across all types of diabetes. They're not specific for type 1 diabetes. So how to differentiate the type 1 diabetic from the majority, that is type 2 diabetes? Insulin deficient diabetics are classically thin, unless they are already taking insulin. And they may be identified by this hallmark. They have a low BMI. They are thin people. Or if they were originally fat because of the current obesity epidemic, there is history of obvious gross weight loss, which is usually over the preceding weeks. Sometimes rarely over months, but usually it's a very short history of rapid weight loss without any other reason. Presentation, clinical features of polyuria, polydipsia, and weight loss are very prominent. There may be abdominal pain, vomiting, sometimes an underlying infection that precipitates it, plus biochemical evidence of hyperglycemia with or without evidence of ketones in the blood or urine. Further evidence, younger age of onset, absence of markers of insulin resistance, which will be there in type 2 diabetes. That is a normal waist circumference, no fatty liver, no acanthosis nigricans. This is further evidence towards the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes as compared to type 2. And one more important thing. If there is a single ever episode of documented DKA, but remember it's D plus K plus A, that means hyperglycemia with ketones and with acidosis documented, all three together, whether it occurred 20 years before, this patient is a type 1 diabetic for all practical purposes. So a single episode of DKA is diagnostic. If you're still in doubt as to whether your patient has type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, you can go for the laboratory tests, including insulin to glucose ratio. Normal ratio is roughly about 1:20. 1 being the insulin and 20 being the glucose in milligrams per deciliter. If this is disturbed, that is the insulin is low as compared to the glucose level, then this also points towards insulin deficiency. The important thing is it should be simultaneously measured in the same sample. You cannot rely on a glucose measured in the clinic and an insulin measured in the laboratory elsewhere. Remember, for all hormonal assays, these are difficult assays and quality controls are not available in every laboratory. Choose your lab very carefully when you're ordering insulin or any other hormone for that matter. If you're still not sure about the diagnosis, then you can check for antibody assays in DMC in our unit. We sometimes have them, not the whole year, but ICA, IAA, GAD, IA2A, these are often available in our unit. So we can help you there if you're in doubt. Since type 1 diabetes mainly affects children, so remember that a single raised blood sugar reading with typical symptoms is enough to diagnose diabetes, particularly in children and in practically all type 1 diabetics. You should not perform an OGTT or a glucose tolerance test, particularly in children, because these patients have very gross hyperglycemia and exposing them to further glucose can be detrimental. So moving on to the management, I will be focusing my talk on the diabetic child, not the adults, because the majority of the type 1 diabetics are children. You are obviously in the middle of the healthcare team that participates in the management of the diabetic child, and in our setup, probably you are the only person there. So you will have to act as the diabetes educator, the nutritionist, and probably the child psychiatrist as well. Priorities of management: first, treat the urgent problems, educate and support your patient. Second, find and treat the complications, baseline blood complete examination, urine, RFTs, lipids, lipids only after the sugar control has been stabilized. Again, educate and support. Prevent further complications. That is the third aim of management, educate and support. And in case you have missed the word, or maybe I haven't emphasized it enough, education is very important, particularly in the type 1. I will divide the management into two parts. The early management is for those diabetics who have recently been diagnosed, and then we will move on to the stable patient. Start the child on insulin. If it's a child and you think the patient has type 1 diabetes, start him on insulin. Do not wait. Subsequent diagnosis of the type of diabetes can be made after metabolic stability has been achieved. It is important in the beginning to rule out DKA and treat any underlying stress condition. Remember, ketones are a must-check in all patients with hyperglycemia, and particularly at first presentation. We think that DKA is a very ill patient. The patient might be in coma, but remember, DKA usually walks into the clinic, contrary to usual belief. The patient may not look ill, but he may still have DKA. So if there are ketones, then you should not delay emergency referral. The patient needs hospital care. Now, coming on to the management of the stable patient, we are trying to ensure that he grows up into a normal, healthy adult. So, sabse pehle, again, education, that is the cornerstone. You have to teach the patient, the child, the parents, the relatives, probably the teachers as well. You have to explain the diagnosis. You have to explain the need for immediate insulin, explain what normal glucose levels are, give them the targets, give them the practical skills, how to inject insulin, basic dietetic advice, what is hypoglycemia, how to prevent TKA, and the effects of exercise, effects of school routine. Give the facts. Talk to the parents, talk to the child. Make sure they share the facts with everybody the child comes in contact with. Make sure they do not hide the diagnosis from anyone. The teachers, the ayahs, the gatekeepers, the friends, the parents of the friends, they all need to know the child has type 1 diabetes. Children with diabetes have certain rights at school. There's a list and it's available, and the parents should know that. This includes snacking if there is risk of hypoglycemia, and certain other things as well. You should try to educate yourself and then the parents about this. Now, moving on to the hyperglycemia, we're going to lower it. Before attempting diet, exercise, or insulin, remember each child is different, comes from a different background. So find your patient's daily routine and try to make minimal changes. A square peg will not fit into a round hole. And the second most important thing is predictability. You have to be able to predict ke patient ki blood sugar hai. If it's it should be on a stable profile. If it's high, it's high all the time. If it's low, it's low all the time. That can be achieved by a normal routine. If your child eats the same thing at the same time every day, exercises the same amount at the same time every day, goes to sleep on the same time, gets up at the same time, this is not difficult. It may sound a little robot-like, but it's not difficult. It is achievable. Give them a routine. Rather, ask them what is your routine and adjust it and make sure they follow the same routine every day. Then the blood sugar profile will not fluctuate. Remember, if there are fluctuations, you won't be able to help them very much. So regularity and consistency is perhaps the most important management issue in type 1 diabetic children particularly. And really, under cover of insulin, the type 1 diabetic child can have almost anything, provided he has it every day, at the very same time, in the very same amount, and can indulge in any sports, provided he exercises at the same time for the same duration every day. Because then you'll know what's happening and you can adjust the insulin accordingly. If it's low, you bring it down. If it's high, you take it up. They are deficient in insulin, that's it. They are children. So you can adjust the insulin according to their routine. Now, glycemic control, blood sugar level rests on, let's say, three pillars: exercise, diet, and insulin, or the pharmacotherapy. So we'll take them up one by one. Diabetic diet is nothing different from a healthy diet. It's mostly substitution of low GI index carbohydrates with high GI, low GI carbohydrate carbohydrates should be substituted for high GI index carbohydrates, and they form the major bulk of the diet, with about 20 to 30% proteins and a small amount of fats added to it. Again, an important point that we tend to miss: a healthy diet should be followed by everyone. Your child will never be able to maintain his blood sugar profile, and he will not be able to diet according to your instructions if his sister is having chocolates in front of him. So treat the whole family, and it will be good for the whole. Sample diet charts are available. It's not included in this presentation at the moment. Among the diet, the proteins, okay, the fats, all right, about 20 to 30% of both. The carbohydrates, it's important to switch from the bad carbs to the good carbs. And why? Because certain carbohydrates have a high glycemic index. The glycemic index measures how fast and how much a food raises blood glucose level. Foods with a low glycemic index release energy slowly, and patient feels full for longer, and they eat less. There is less hypoglycemia with these. So substitute the high GI foods like starches and refined carbohydrates with low GI alternates. This is important in the diet. Otherwise, carbohydrate counting and dose adjustment for normal eating, these are concepts, good concepts, being practiced in the West. Currently, they're not very practical in our setup. So let's just move on. So the diet checklist. Individualize the diet plan according to your patient's lifestyle and growth needs. Create a timetable. Small, frequent, split meals. As Dr. Saira said, small meals are easy to handle. Do not limit calories in children. Match the insulin profile, whatever insulin you are giving. Match the activity profile, exercise. Do not eliminate fat from the diet of children. Just replace it with healthy fats. And give sufficient proteins. They are growing kids, remember. Substitute the high GI carbs with low GI alternates. After diet, we'll move on to exercise. Well, exercise is good for everybody, and children with diabetes should get at least 1 hour a day of moderate physical activity. Additional activities to improve bone health, muscle strength, and flexibility at least twice a week. Routine exercise incorporated into the daily timetable is safe for children. However, if the child plans to go for strenuous exercise, the control must be stabilized first because of the risks of hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia, and dehydration. If the child is going for unaccustomed exercise, then you must check the... Sorry.
Thank you for this rude interruption. We have with us Professor Faisal Masood, and it's not every day that you see him at a program. Please give him a standing ovation. Please stand up for him, please. Thank you very much, sir.
So before going for unaccustomed exercise, the diabetic child should check the blood sugar level before, during, immediately after, and even up to 24 hours after the exercise because of the risk of post-exercise nocturnal hypoglycemia. Strenuous exercise or unaccustomed exercise, tell the child to take a warm-up. 5 to 10 minutes warm-up time and cool-down period, such as walking and stretching. Take lots of fluids to avoid dehydration and keep sugary sweets handy in case of hypoglycemia. This table shows the guidelines for the type of exercise and what to do For example, if there's a short-term exercise, like the patient is walking to the shop, it takes about 20 minutes, do nothing, just carry rapid-acting carbohydrates. Medium-term, gentle exercise like cycling for about 35 to 45 minutes, and an additional 1 to 2 carbohydrate portions, that means about 1 to 2 pieces of bread. Prolonged, intense exercise, 4 hours of cycling, well, usually our children don't go for that kind of activity, but still, that would require reduction in the insulin dose and extra carbohydrate portions. Any significant extra exercise will probably require a dose reduction in insulin of maybe 20 to 50% and carbohydrate snacks if hypoglycemia is anticipated. If there's hyperglycemia during exercise or before exercise, then stop exercising. Check the ketones, give fluids, give insulin. Now, when not to allow exercise? Hyperglycemia, because ketoacidosis may be precipitated, and erratic control. Your patient's control is not stable. You don't know what's going to happen. Patients with complications of diabetes, proliferative retinopathy and nephropathy, patients should avoid exercises likely to result in high blood pressure levels. And patients with advanced neuropathy should avoid exercises like football. Now, we're done with exercise. Now, let's move on to the pharmacotherapy of the type 1 diabetic. That is insulin. Remember, no oral insulins in type 1 diabetes. This is very important. Why? Because sulfonylureas and methylglyonides, they may temporarily bring the blood sugar levels down, but they will do so at the cost of squeezing insulin out of the already weak pancreas beta cells. And they are absolutely contraindicated in type 1 diabetes. Because if the pancreas is totally burnt out, then optimal control is really impossible thereon. So you have to remember that one aim of management of the type 1 diabetic child is glycemic control to prevent the complications, and the second aim of management is to preserve the beta cells as much as possible. So do not give oral agents in a patient you think is type 1 diabetic. Which insulin regime depends on the patient. One shoe wouldn't fit all, so you'll have to individualize. But basal bolus regime, the one that Dr. Saira mentioned in the management of gestational diabetes, that is usually recommended. There are multiple regimes using regular insulin as boluses before the meals and NPH at bedtime, or maybe rapid acting in combination with the long acting analogs. You can choose the one that fits your patient's lifestyle. What is the dose of insulin that is required? Remember, the correct dose is that which achieves the best glycemic control for the individual child or adolescent without causing obvious hypoglycemia and resulting in harmonious growth according to the child's weight and height chart. Insulin requirement fluctuates in children much more than in adults. Pre-pubertal children, about 0.7 to 1 unit per kg per day, roughly. During puberty, it can go up to 2 units per kg per day. And during the partial remission phase, it can drop down to below 0.5 units per kg per day, even totally disappear at times. Now, starting insulin in the clinic. Okay, let's go for some practical work. So, control the diet according to the patient's BMI and coexisting conditions. Adjust the timetable so the profile is stabilized. For control of blood sugar in an uncomplicated, oral-free patient receiving insulin for the first time, there are many formulas, there are many ways, but what we do. Calculate the initial total daily dose according to the formula. You divide the body weight in kgs by 2. For example, a 48 kg person will require roughly about 24 units. This is the dose per day. Split this into 4 equal parts. Give 3 as regular injections before the meals, and give the 4th quarter at 11 p.m. as NPH. This is the basal insulin. No food to follow this one. For example, in the 48 kg diabetic requiring 24 units per day, we start with at 8 a.m. 6 units regular insulin, half hour before breakfast. At 2 p.m. 6 units regular insulin, half hour before lunch. 8 p.m. 6 units, 11 p.m. 6 units of NPH. You can see there's a 6 hours gap between the 3 regular insulins. This is important because it matches the profile of the regular insulin. Now, control the BSF, ignore the postprandial random blood sugar readings, focus on controlling the fasting glucose levels. It is important to remember that random readings or postprandial readings, they will be controlled when the fasting blood glucose has been stabilized and brought down to normal. Do not attempt to go for postprandial regular insulin before the meals. Do not attempt to change that unless your fasting is controlled. Check BSF after about 1 or 2 days. Adjust the dose of nighttime NPH accordingly. Keep on increasing the dose of NPH, 2 units, 4 units, until the fasting levels will come down by decreasing the NPH insulin. Now control the blood sugar fasting. So remember, fasting is controlled by adjusting the prior dose of NPH. And once the fasting has been controlled, check 6-point blood sugars, fasting 2 hours after breakfast, before lunch, 2 hours after lunch, before dinner, and 2 hours after dinner. Now control any raised random readings by adjusting the dose of the previously administered regular insulin. For example, if the reading after the lunch is high, you will adjust the pre-lunch insulin, not the next insulin, as in the sliding scale. So control random sugar level by adjusting the prior dose of regular insulin. I have 2 examples, but I think I'm running short in time. There are handouts available, and you can take a look at this later on. Okay. Now, this will work, but only if there is a stable routine that does not vary from day to day. Remember, when your patients are on insulin, they will require mid-meal snacks. Anticipate hypoglycemia about 3 hours after regular insulin, so either give a snack at 3 hours after the main meal or 2 snacks 2 hours apart between the meals. Similarly, advise snack after dinner to counter for hypoglycemia. However, each child would behave differently, so monitor and adjust. Pearls for practice, briefly reviewing what we've done so far. Never adjust insulin dose without maximally attempting to stabilize the diet and exercise. Always bring fasting sugar to normal before trying to control the postprandial blood sugars. Control any underlying infection or stressful condition vigorously. Keep meals 6 hours apart. Give timed snacks between meals. Do not inject NPH before 11 p.m. Otherwise, it will not last till the morning. Do not use sliding scale, please, to calculate the dose of insulin. Use proper technique to inject subcutaneous insulin and ensure proper storage of insulin. A few words about analogs. There are short-acting analogs like Lispro, Glulisine, and Aspart, and there are long-acting analogs, Detemer and Glargine. When to use them? Certain scenarios, if your child is going into hypoglycemia between meals, well, you may replace regular with Lispro, Glulisine, or Aspart, but you can also tackle the problem by increasing the number or amount of mid-meal snacks. If the diabetes is brittle, like there's erratic control, the patient is going into hypo and hyper. What we do is we try to regularize the timetable, control any stress, but we may substitute Detemer or Glargine in place of NPH. If there's Somogai, we should decrease the NPH, but we may substitute NPH with Detemer or better Glargine because it does not have a peak. So analogs, should you give them, should you not, it's your decision. It's a benefit, cost-benefit ratio. Injection technique, there are multiple sites advocated for insulin. What do we do? First of all, you should use the same site every day and every injection because of predictability. The absorption kinetics vary from one site to another. And the preferred site is the abdominal wall. Why? Easy access, fewer pain receptors, ample subcutaneous tissue, absorption minimally affected by exercise. This works. Insulin should be injected in the same general area of the body for consistency, but not the exact same place. Keep the needle perpendicular to abdominal wall in order to avoid variability in absorption. 45 degrees if the patient is very lean. Insert needle up to the hilt after injecting. Count to 10 slowly before taking the syringe out. Distribute daily injections over a wide area to avoid lipodystrophy and other local complications while avoiding 2 fingers around the umbilicus. So which one is correct? Okay, this one is nearest to correct because it's perpendicular. You should give the injection at 90 degrees and pinch up the skin so you go into the subcutaneous tissue and so there is minimal damage. Insulin storage is very important, particularly in our country. So insulin, do not freeze it, no direct sunlight, warming. There should be no change in the appearance of the insulin. If the appearance is changed, then discard it. Refrigerate the insulin, preferably in the dough compartment. After first usage, insulin vial should be discarded after 3 months if kept at 2 to 8 Celsius or 10 days to 4 weeks if kept at room temperature. Remember, cleaning the tip of the needle with alcohol removes the coating that helps the needle slide into the skin easily. This should be avoided. It makes the injection painful. And you should be careful about blunt needles and about infections. Continuous glucose monitoring systems with insulin pumps, they are new, they are good, they are expensive, they are available in our department. If you want to refer any patients, this is an option for children. Now, moving on to the monitoring, we are done with the diet, the exercise, and the insulin therapy. How to monitor? Well, the children, their developmental progress is a means to monitor the glycemic control. If the school performance is not going good, you should suspect erratic blood glucose control, hypoglycemia, maybe hyperglycemia. Their growth charts, monitor their growth charts. Other than that, frequent monitoring of blood glucose at home. This is very important. Frequent review is very useful to identify patterns in glycemic levels, but they should know how to do it. Teach them. And, well, they should not be used as a judgment, but as a vehicle for discussing the causes of variability and strategies for improving glycemic control. What are the targets? Fasting, they are slightly lenient for children. As they grow up into adults, they would become stricter. But fasting 90 to 145, postprandial 90 to 180, bedtime 120 to 180, nocturnal 90 to 162 milligrams per deciliter, and an HbA1c of 7.5 to 8.5. HbA1c should be monitored 4 to 6 times per year in younger children, 3 to 4 times per year in older children. Tell them not to smoke, particularly the young boys. Retinopathy, initial eye examination after diagnosis, and it is recommended that either at the age of 11 years or after 2 years of diabetes duration, whichever comes first, monitoring for retinopathy should start. Similarly for nephropathy. What is important in nephropathy is that 2 of 3 urine collections should be used as evidence of microalbuminuria. This may resolve. It may be intermittent, it may persist, confounders, urinary tract infections, exercise, menstrual bleeding. So reconfirm microalbuminuria before labeling the patient as nephropathy. Neuropathy screening, again, 11 years or 2 years of diabetes. Foot examination yearly or more frequent if there are risk factors. Lipid profile, children over 12 years of age, they should be screened. Or if there are risk factors like family history of hypercholesterolemia, early cardiovascular disease, or if the family history is unknown, screening should start at the age of 2 years. Then if there are normal results, repeat every 5 years. Targets lower than LDL cholesterol, lower than 100 milligrams per deciliter. Remember, statins may be considered, like in long-term safety of these in children is not yet established. Remember to rule out celiac disease, at least think about it in type diabetics. Certain special circumstances, hypoglycemia, you should know the symptoms, your patient should know the symptoms, weakness, shaking, sweating, headache, nervousness, hunger, confusion, fits. Treatment, they should keep simple sugars handy. It should be taken and then followed by a full meal. This is important. And retest the blood glucose 10 to 15 minutes after treatment to confirm resolution. Then 30 minutes later to confirm adequate treatment and parenteral treatment if there are neurological signs. And then find the cause of hypoglycemia. Where's the cause? You will have to look back. Diet, exercise, insulin. One of these three. There's something wrong in one of these three. So insulin action profile, recent food intake, recent physical activity. Get the history, you'll find the cause. And then you can tell the child or tell the parents how to avoid such instances in the future. Hypoglycemia. Okay, just a few more slides. I'm sorry, I'm taking extra time. Hypoglycemia unawareness is important because there would be symptoms of neuroglycopenia only. There would be no symptoms, and this is dangerous. Blood glucose levels should, jo goals hai humare, they should be adjusted upward if there is recurrent hypoglycemia. And they can, remember, hypoglycemia unawareness can be reversed by scrupulously avoiding a low blood glucose level for just 2 weeks. If you avoid a blood glucose level below 70 milligrams per deciliter for 2 weeks, this condition should resolve. If there is unexplained hypoglycemia, frequent hypoglycemia, look for celiac, think about Edison's, and referral is indicated. Children should wear something to warn others about medical alert, a bracelet or something like that. Tell your children, type 1 diabetic children, to carry some identification. Sick day management, just few words, do not omit insulin. Patient is vomiting, don't omit insulin. Just check the blood sugar frequently. Increased carbohydrates may be needed. Increased fluid intake is usually needed. If the blood sugar goes high, check ketones. One word about neonatal diabetes. If there is a diabetic child below 6 months of age, refer to the endocrinologist because this may be something else. Just two more slides now. The parents of the child with type 1 diabetes are scared. Please recognize this. They need your empathy. They need your support. And these children are our future. Well, we should do as much as we can for them. So I leave you with the saying, we cannot direct the wind, but we can adjust the sails. Thank you.